Python lets you create your own data types with classes. In theory, you can subclass the built-in types to customize them according to your needs. But a better way to accomplish the same thing is to use Python's abstract base class system, or ABC as it's called. And in this example, I'm going to use ABC to create a custom version of Python's dictionary type, one where the inserted values expire after a certain length of time. The idea behind an abstract base class, or again, ABC, is twofold. First, an ABC is not something you instantiate directly. It's something you use as a base, hence base class, for another class that you or somebody else creates. Second, ABCs can describe methods that need to be defined in your class in order for the class to work at all. This is a way to define certain minimal requirements for how the class needs to behave when it's running in your program. So in the example I'm about to show, we use one of Python's own abstract base classes that lets you emulate the behaviors of other types. In this case, it's going to be a dictionary. So let's see this in action. The ABC that we're using for this expiring dictionary example is called mutable mapping. And as I noted, this lets us emulate the interfaces that are provided by dictionary, like setting and getting keys. Instead of subclassing dictionary, though, what we're going to do is create a new type based on mutable mapping, and which has inside it a dictionary instance. We'll call that self.underscore_data. The mutable mapping ABC automatically provides certain kinds of functionality for a dictionary-like type, again, like setting and getting keys. But we have to write a few key underlying interfaces ourselves explicitly. If we don't supply those bits, Python will yell at us. And that's actually a good thing, because it means we can't accidentally write something with an ABC that doesn't have the needed bits for it to work in production. So the two big methods that we need to provide are setItem and getItem. These are the interfaces we use to read from and write to the dictionary. Whenever we set an item with this custom type that we're using, we're actually storing each value as a two-element tuple. The first is a timestamp for when the value was inserted. The second is the value itself. When we retrieve the item using getItem, we extract the data from the tuple and we make sure the timestamp that we've stored with the item is still within the valid range. If it's not, then we remove the key from the dictionary altogether and we raise an error. We also have to provide interfaces for deleting items, for iterating through the dictionary, and for getting the length of the dictionary. The good news is, as you can see here, for all of these, all we need to do is just wrap the existing dictionary interfaces with our abstract base class. We don't have to provide an interface for the object's representation. That's also provided for us automatically. But in this case, I do want to override that so that the representation doesn't contain the timestamps for the stored values. In other words, it's going to look like a regular dictionary representation. We could alter that behavior if we wanted to, though. So when we run this code, you're going to see that we have our newly created dictionary with three values added to it in sequence, one at creation, one via setting from a key, and one via the update method, which, by the way, we got for free with our abstract base class. We didn't have to define that explicitly. We also got for free the items method, and we have the delete method also supported since we wrote that. Now, let's run this code again, but with a sleep inserted. Our timeout for how long keys can live in this dictionary is 2 seconds. So if we create the dict, populate it with data, wait 3 seconds, and then try to read from it, all our read operations will throw a custom exception. So our dictionary now has an auto-expiring functionality. Now, there's a lot of functionality we could still build for this. For instance, we could have the dictionary prune itself automatically at some interval using a thread instead of relying on the read operation to determine whether or not something is valid. But those are advanced exercises I'm going to leave to the viewer. What's important here is that we have an example of how an abstract base class can work, and specifically, how we can use it to create a class that emulates the behavior of an existing built-in type. And we can do that in a way that guarantees the behaviors we need are going to all be supported. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below. And don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.